The Omicron variant really is something, and its spread across England in the latter half of December 2021 proved it was far more virulent than earlier strains were. Masks and hand washing appeared effective in slowing down the spread of Delta, but Omicron bowled straight through all that and seemed to infect everybody almost instantly. In fact, it panned out exactly how I had expected the first wave of the pandemic to have done so, back when it all first started. And it reminded me a bit of that fear that we used to have for it, as almost overnight it suddenly seemed to be everywhere again. Before Omicron, I heard of friends getting COVID. I knew some people online who had it, but it always seemed a bit distant and mysterious. But in December 2021, it seemed like it was here. A lot of friends and family got it, and it did a really good job of sabotaging Christmas for the second year in a row. The good news? Omicron does indeed appear to be a lot more mild than earlier variants were. This is exactly what we want for the disease to become. It would just have been nice had it waited for January to do so. This time around, the government didn't dare impose any restrictions on Christmas. They seemed to be rocked with scandal after scandal, as pictures of politicians attending parties when they should have been locking down during previous waves were suddenly leaked to the public in the weeks leading up to Christmas. So they instead sat back and did nothing, and I think the public picked up the slack by being a bit more cautious as a result. Mask usage has certainly improved in shops and the like again. Newspapers looking for clicks posted headlines like, "Prime Minister doesn't rule out the possibility of lockdowns," but I think most of us can read between the lines now. Yes, they have planned for a worst case scenario, but no, they shouldn't be punished for having prepared for it, and I think they were right to play it by ear and not to lock down this time around. But it is a shame that the booster hadn't been opened up a few weeks sooner. I think that would have helped a lot. Although admittedly, I'm a bit unclear about what effect the vaccines have on the Omicron variant. Apparently it can slip around the protection that existing vaccines provide, but at the same time, the vaccine will still make you less likely to get it, and you'll get lesser symptoms if you do contract it. At this point, beyond the vulnerable, the unvaccinated and the unfortunate, I assume that getting Omicron will be like getting a bad cold that lasts for about a week, and that's about it. Let me tell you what it's like to get the booster jab. In previous waves, we booked an appointment and then walked through a very large-scale and professional-looking setup, complete with private booths and a place to sit afterwards for 15 minutes. But this time around, it was different. It was like a conveyor belt, with the country aiming for 1 million doses a day in an attempt to lessen the impact of the new variant and to save Christmas. So we had booked our appointments, but it was easier just to walk in and to get it, which wasn't just an option, but was actively encouraged this time around. It seemed to be hosted in a different place every day, presumably to reach as many people as possible, many of whom may be unable to attend the central football stadium where most of it had been carried out previously. We turned up at what looked like a village hall with about a dozen people in the line ahead of us. Once we were inside, it was over and done within a couple of minutes. One person behind the tables filling up the needles and another person administering them. It was fast and brutally efficient. And while I was just as pathetic and squeamish about receiving the jab as I had been previously, I barely felt it this time. They've had a lot of practice. And then we were out, without even waiting around for 15 minutes just in case. Word of advice, don't wear white. They don't even bother giving you a plaster this time. It's a conveyor belt. I got the Moderna vaccine for the third time, and I wasn't sure what the side effects were going to be like. The first jab did nothing. The second forced me to bed for 24 hours, so either this one was going to be better or worse than that. And given the smaller dosage for the booster, I hoped it would be better. But it wasn't. Every time this happens, I think that if I brace myself for it in advance and fight it really hard, that somehow I'll be able to carry on with my life as normal instead of wasting a day in bed. But that's easier said than done, given that this damn thing is literally like the flu, but with a worse headache, worse sleep, and not as much of the nice achy muscly bit, which is the bit I always liked about the flu. So I was editing together the previous COVID video when I started feeling rough. I was adamant that I'd get it released before going to bed, but within about 2 hours, it reduced me to being like, "Ugh, let's do it tomorrow instead." And then it was 24 hours before I could muster the strength to release it, despite that process requiring about 2 minutes of my time. I was horribly ill for a day and a half. I had a horrendous headache, I was hot, I was cold, I was constantly tired but unable to sleep. I had a long time to think about that headache. It ranged between 4 and 6 out of 10 on the pain scale for me, between being very unpleasant to being so bad that I was counting to 100 over and over again until I could take the next paracetamol. So the night following the vaccine, I was hallucinating that I was a triangle in London getting the vaccine over and over again, but then I was worried that I wasn't in London anymore, and I'd wake up out of this. I'd drag myself to the toilet, have some water, but the moment I got back to bed, the nightmare would continue. It was one of the longest nights of my life. The following day, I stayed in bed until 3 p.m. I got out of bed, had some food, and then went back to bed again. And then I managed to drag myself out of bed again a bit later on to get the video out. My sleep tracker thinks I slept for 13 hours that day. I would say it was more than that, but even if I was awake, most of the day was spent lying in bed, and I can only wish I had managed to sleep more. But that night when I went to bed, I went hot, and I remained hot. I stripped off the covers and just lay there, managing to be too cold and too hot at the same time. I had no idea what I was supposed to do, so for the best part of like 4 hours, I was just curled up in a ball soaking the mattress. I still felt too hot for the best part of a week, and my resting heart rate shot up to 10 above normal, and it's still there 3 weeks later. So it hasn't been pleasant, and the idea of getting a fourth vaccine might be enough to finish me off. So yeah, I wouldn't rate the experience of being vaccinated a third time very highly. And at this point, I do wonder if I'd just be better off taking my chances with COVID instead. I got my shot, and then it was just a matter of not getting COVID for long enough for it to grant me some degree of protection against it. Against Omicron, it's apparently most effective 2 to 4 weeks after getting the jab. And then beyond that, who knows? Some sources say protection wanes within a couple of months. Others say that you remain far better protected against COVID because the booster is like getting a university degree of protection against it, whereas fewer jabs is like only having a school or college education. But I remember when the second jab was meant to be many magnitudes better than having just one, and now we're being told that 3 is magnitudes better than 2, but that it still won't stop you from getting COVID. Several times. Not that that matters, since vaccines were only ever meant to protect you against severe disease, and that's all that matters. Although its impact on severe disease right now is unknown. It looks like you can read what you want to and claim it to be the truth, but if you read enough, it becomes clear that people just don't have a clue about how existing vaccines stack up against Omicron. So what's the best strategy here? To try and huff some Omicron during that 2 week window where the vaccine is most effective? Or to receive a vaccine every 2 months from now on? At this rate, the side effects I get from them are eventually going to outlast the protection they offer me. I understand that we're doing what we can with what we've got, but I'm not impressed, and the current vaccines seriously need to be replaced by something more effective and longer lasting, and hopefully not so horrible to have. Christmas, the thing we try to look forward to all year, and the thing COVID really seems to want to ruin. One of my friends went up to London on a date, came back, tested positive for COVID, spent Christmas inside their room, masking up to go to the toilet. Nobody else in the house caught it. They raised an interesting point that in Cornwall, radiation levels are high inside houses, so radon pumps are often used to pump air out from underneath the house. And they speculated that it probably also helps the airflow inside the house itself. In Household 2, one person came back from London and tested positive on the day of arrival. Again, it seems to be a trend with COVID. So they quarantined in a room off from the living room, while the rest of the house all tried to go ahead with Christmas as normal, but with that person behind a closed door. I got a sad message from one of them saying that they were stuck in a house full of people coughing, but weren't ill themselves yet. And I felt so sorry for them. If only I could somehow have known this was going to happen beforehand and warned them. Or maybe there's still time to rescue them before they get it. Though I think we both knew it was too late by then. And sure enough, that person fell ill with COVID and quarantined in another room for 10 days. Interestingly though, the parents remained uninfected. And the same in Household 1, so maybe having the booster at least several weeks before exposure does make a big difference. One of my friends, and indeed myself, had to change our plans when somebody in the house we were going to attend at Christmas fell ill from COVID. But for us, this happened before we visited them. So yeah, I was very lucky and managed to spend Christmas in relative normality with my family. After having been to London a few weeks before, I was sure I was going to fall ill. I left it until the day I was heading down to test myself, and it tested negative. But you know how you get yourself worked up and you think you've got a sore throat or are coming down with something. And I was really concerned over Christmas that I'd eventually test positive and then would be responsible for exposing the rest of my family. But nothing happened and I didn't get ill and neither did anybody else. But I felt irresponsible simply for attending Christmas. The dreaded moment is when you test yourself, when you know that if it does turn out to be positive, then you'll probably already have infected several other people. And this isn't something I've had to endure yet. And I can say that I had a lovely Christmas and that my parents even dropped me back home themselves because they didn't want me risking the train. I've been hiding in the house ever since. It seems so random whether or not you're going to get COVID. It really makes me think that, even after all this, we still don't really understand transmission of diseases all that well, and what exactly decides whether somebody gets ill or not. Because even in situations where there would have been a high viral load, some people fall ill while others seem to avoid it completely, and in ways which don't correlate with age or health. But it does seem like Omicron is virulent before it even shows up on a test. Somebody I know who got COVID knew that they had it several days before the test confirmed it, claiming that they could feel it in their throat. And it looks like people who have already had COVID can and will get Omicron as well, even within a month or so of their previous infection. It's tearing through the population so quickly, I think it'll be over within a month or so. I remember a time when purple on the COVID map was bad. Now there are massive areas of black across the country. Nowhere has escaped it this time. And it's taken its toll on businesses and services. Predictably, there have been a lot of staff shortages over the new year, and that many hospitals are cancelling non-urgent procedures now. It's happening even in my city, which is far from the worst affected place in the country. That's the gist of it, but truthfully, I know I'm one of the worst people in the country to report on how it's going, since I'm holed up in my home, away from people. There's a shortage of tests now, and the positivity rate has exceeded the point where we can still accurately track the number of infections in this country. But I'm still proud of England for our efforts up to this point. We've not been great at containing it, but have been one of the best for testing and for sequencing it. It's been the most greatly monitored diseases in the history of mankind. There's been a global effort to track, to analyse and to combat this disease, and obviously we're all a bit busy right now dealing with it. But after COVID has passed, we will have so much great data from this. It could change everything, from how we combat the next pandemic to how we ventilate buildings. Hopefully we'll finally do something about all those toilet doors that you have to touch as you're leaving them. That never made sense to me, and will be the first thing to go come the post-pandemic health craze. You know it's coming. We won't be going back to how we were before, and I guess I've got to try and see that as progress.